So everyone, thanks for coming and sorry for the demo effect of work, but let's see at the demo I can undo that. So I'm Joonas Lahtinen and I'm the Anand 15 co-maintainer for the module for the graphics. Let's say memory management and graphics submission would be my deal, and then there would be Jani Nikula handling the display side, and then we have Rob Rikola also. So, but I have a kind of a history with having to remotely access the devices, because usually any device that you're going to do doing new development with will be closer to the factory than your home. So either you will be traveling.
Okay. I still put them on mute.
Okay. Better now?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. So there will be always remote. So there is certain amount of pain in the trying to access them. So I decided to kind of share my experiences with it. So I'm going to briefly go over the what it actually means in this context that I'm talking about, and then we'll go about the open source solution that there is for this issue. So the question is to how to remotely access machine for graphics development. So it's kind of different for many developers, especially for general developers, when they are accessing, they are mostly using the SSH and locally. So in order to kind of open it up more, we need to kind of think what it means to be using it remotely. So when you have a device on your desktop, you would be using it. Not nowadays anymore so much, but used to be, you would be using serial port to debug some early booting issues. For example, when you do some KMS, there will be deadlock and the kernel simply won't come up. So that'll be a way of like the last results. And nowadays it's going to be harder, because fewer parts will be having serial port that is easily accessible. So there is nowadays the USB debug port, and even for the USB 3.0 you have an alternative. But the support is kind of, I've tried to set it up a few times in mainliner, and it's currently hard to get working. So I think net console is then the kind of go-to solution, but that can solve only so much your issues. So I have highlighted points in the slide that you probably would normally be, or traditionally be, remotely accessing. So the display, not only the remote desktop, so the for somebody purely working on the 3D side and the user space, they are probably fine with the desktop viewer. But for the kernel, you really want to know if your kernel mode setting is working, and if you want to go to BIOS and you want to be able to fix that BIOS, because usually, especially the new devices, the BIOS is still a little bit flaky at times. And then for that, you need the keyboard and mouse, so SSH isn't quite enough, even if our Intel chips have been in the news for remote accessing, but it's not been in the positive side lately. So, and then it's the USB sticks, that's also something, so you probably want to download that BIOS somewhere, and then also be booting whatever you get a report from somebody that it's not working on this specific distro, so you want to be live booting that distro also. So for that, and power control is pretty soft. I'm sure Martin is still here, but for example, the camera scheme. So there are various solutions for, depending on how much you're willing money on it, for controlling the power of the devices. But that's of course something you will definitely be yanking the plugs if you have the device on your desk. If it's simply not doing anything, but so you need it. Be able to do that remotely too. So here is kind of a simplified. I have assembled the system here on my desk, but it will probably be easier to look up from the slide. So this is what you would be kind of expecting for a fluent remote usage of a machine. And it's also shouldn't for, let's say, open source average contributor, it probably shouldn't be too expensive either. There are lots of KVM IP solution, of course, but those are not, you can't modify those, and you can, or well, you reverse engineer them, but to start with something open would be kind of a nice touch. So, I have been looking and trying quite a few different things, and I came down to these for at least the current time, so I'm always looking for the next kind of alternative. So it's not a Raspberry Pi, unfortunately, so it's a beagle bone for black, because the Raspberry Pi won't give you the USB gadget, and then the Raspberry Pi Zeros that do get you that, they can't be, well, you have to do soldering if you want to power them from a DC power supply. So I think one idea here is because we are going to be deploying this in the lab environment, and I won't be necessarily there to do the soldering, so it has to be kind of be able to be put together by the lab engineers, and then I will just be able to then use that machine. So for the BeagleBone Black, you would basically be, the mainline kernel will be running, but obviously DI hasn't been completely perfect with all the patches, so the performance, if you are, for example, looking to do some network routing with the device, is going to be on the bad side. So, but Robert Nelson has been working on kind of building off the, you know, you can download, you can flash it, and it will perform really nicely. And it's 4.14, I think, the latest DBM, so it's not that old. Pretty nice. And then there's, yeah, there are also, I'm not sure how much mainline is being run on those, these single port computers, because for example, when I tried the mainline kernel, I found that there has been for half a year there's a regression in the BeagleBone Black device 3 that it will basically make the USB gadget unusable before you revert that. So it's, so yeah. You know, that sense, if you want to get those cheap off-the-shelf components, you might have to end up using the DI-provided kernel in this case, for example. So yeah, and then the linking HDMI center will be to just order it from your random eBay vendor, and they ship it to you. It's about 30 euros, and it will basically work out of the box. But I know that there are a lot of hackers here, so I guess there is a lot of reverse engineering, and you can, there are alternative firmwares to the device, so you can basically get it to go up to full HD and then do pretty much all the resolutions down from full HD. But even if you get it, when you ship it to you from the eBay, it will be doing both 720p and then full HD, but it will be downscaling the full HD. To the 720p, but that's actually quite convenient, because when you are, for example, running benchmarks on your remote device, you are probably going to be comparing to somebody. The reporter probably had full HD display, or nowadays would be 4K too, but full HD is still kind of the standard for performance. So you will actually get the performance numbers for the full HD, but you only use the 720p bandwidth over, well, your blatant VPN connection to whatever site you need to be accessing. And then it has some quirks to the device, so it's setting UDP packets of zero length, so that's not exactly illegal, but most of the software currently except the latest version of FFmpeg won't manage with that, so you probably want to be doing a firewall from those. So yeah, like with FFmpeg, it's quite straightforward. When you get the cable connected to the device, you can just, the device will always, it's always on, even when your machine isn't putting any HDMI signal, so you will at least get a low signal picture from the system. So it's quite convenient when you need to like check the progress. Even if you would be using SSH to launch the performance like benchmark, you would be viewing them from the screen easily. And then you have for GStreamer, but unfortunately with this specific device, GStreamer is struggling when you are doing a kernel mode setting or whatever mode setting, and we kind of resetting the encoder, timestamping numbering, and that will scale down GStreamer, unfortunately. So if somebody's expert in European emails, you know. Because GStreamer otherwise actually will result in a smaller latency between the interactions and then the video, so I prefer that. And then I'm just also for the text every time, you know, you can also, if you're interested in only the picture part of the stream, it's easy to strip it out, and then you will be saving some of that VPN bandwidth. And also because not all networks are created equal, UDP is kind of difficult thing, so you can combine with the legal one black here, just make it a proxy either with EsoCat, you know, we can do the way. But I guess you might be, even the UDP TXT is nowadays being replaced by a commercial product. There is some patches, there was even month ago with. Yeah, so, but it will do it with a much lesser load, so you will be able to do other duties with the, for example, transferring files with DecoCompact, so, yeah. So for controlling, of course, as this is going to be about the open source utilities, and we already have a great USB gadget stack in the Linux kernel, so you basically don't need anything else. So from the BeagleBone Black, you will be plugging the USB gadget cable to the host device, and that's it. You will be able to have your mouse, keyboard, serial port, and any mass storage gadget there. So basically, that will fulfill most of the needs when you already have the display with the HDMI encoder. And this is the way at least how I started it. When you really, really just need to get down to it, you can go to command line and you can write to the heat descriptors, or you know, like the heat packages, like raw. Here I've highlighted, so it's a bit like you would be programming with logo or something. You try to hit that button, you go a little bit too far, you need to come back a little bit. So. And with the keys, of course, then there will be, because the heat protocol will only give you the changes for the keys, so you have to be a little bit smarter and write a script that will do the typing for you. But it's easy to generate those even for a lengthy command sessions. And then there is a caveat that, you know, if you're wondering why it's not working, you probably don't have the length correctly for your. So in the demo, there was time, I think I go through the rest of the slides, and then let's see for the demo. So from what I've described here, you know, when you, because you might have some delays with your network, it might be more beneficial instead of sending the complete heat report from the remote machine to the destination, just send an indication that I want button pressed for a brief period of time, because otherwise you will be getting those sticky keys, and that's then going to ruin that, you know, script that you have been running. And then Chameleon was brought up when I demoed this at our office, so yeah, it's going to be one frames per second. Currently you can get to 60 frames per second with the native encoder, but then it's only HDMI, and we're of course not sure how long this will be available, but I hear that Chameleon 2 will be even better, but not necessarily on the decoding side, because it's not a thing for them, but it might be in the future. Okay, so how much do I have?
7 minutes, so.
Okay, so let's right. I'm kind of hopeful to have this from that. First of all, power from everything. So that's done. And if there are any questions in the while I'm packing, please ask out my answer. Could be not related to exactly the, what I was presenting, but maybe to the remote access. I've been accessing the machines remotely for quite a long time, trying to come up with something smart, including if QR codes and webcams taken into kind of cardboard box and fragments, but this is something that for various reasons. Issues with the device, so. So I guess then it's, if any questions, not then I will have to, okay.
Yeah, so if you're not specifically trying to debug at this driver, have you looked into other options, like using the GPU for rendering, but having the brain buffer transfer via something VNC line?
Yeah, so as I'm working with the I915 driver and we are not even on, I'm not even on the display side, but in the memory management. So usually when something goes south, we don't maybe even get the, you know, any buffers. We just get the UEFI console. So it's kind of, so I haven't been doing that, but that is of course an option and it should be pretty easy to do with the, you can have prime export of the display surface. Any other question? Okay, so if not, then I will thank